One of the arguments in favor of markets is that they're supposed to provide for individual choice. Exactly. So they're kind of democratic. They allow everyone to choose. It's quite the opposite.
Yeah.
Markets radically restrict choice in very important ways. So let's be concrete. I have to get home tonight, right? The market does offer me a choice between a Toyota and a Chevrolet. It does not offer me a choice between a car and a subway. That would be better for me, would be better for my grandchildren, it helps save the environment and so on, but that's not a choice available in the market. Markets sharply restrict choices to individual consumption. For one, that has many negative aspects to it, quite apart from externalities. For one thing, it means that lots of choices just aren't available. The choices that an individual might prefer, and say I would prefer. But furthermore, it kind of exaggerates the most negative aspects of human potentiality. It turns you into someone who is dedicated to maximizing individual gain, not social concern.
Yeah.
Exactly the opposite of what Smith, Hume, and others took to be the essential of human nature. That's intrinsic to markets.
Yeah.
Quite apart from that comes the question of externalities,
yeah.
which by now are species destroying.
Yeah.
I mean, it's inherent to markets that ExxonMobil will try to maximize profit independently of what happens to the fate of the species, and they're doing it.
Yeah.
So ExxonMobil just announced again that they're not going to waste any resources on the marginal profit that you might get from sustainable energy. They're going to try to extract all the fossil fuel they can with new technology, and there'll be huge profits and so on. Of course, the grandchildren may not have a world to live in, but that doesn't matter. Part of market economics is you don't care about the fate of your grandchildren. You care about more profit tomorrow. These are all essential aspects of markets and among the reasons why they're literally lethal. Destructive to the individual because of the sharp restriction of choice to individual gain. It creates, it almost inherently creates a kind of sociopathic society. It maximizes the sociopathic elements of human relations and even individual psychology, and it's also just completely unsustainable. Actually, take a look at history. There are a few cases where markets were in fact actually functioned. One of them is the Third World. In fact, that's how the Third World became the Third World. As in the case of Egypt and India, they just had these conditions forced on them. So then, yes, they deindustrialized and became what the United States would have become if it had followed Adam Smith's recommendations. They were free, so they could do the opposite. Now, the other interesting case is England. In 1846, England was way in advance of other societies industrially. It had more than twice the per capita capitalization of any other country. So under those conditions, England's merchants and manufacturers, the ruling classes, could consider the possibility of accepting free trade because they were going to win. Anyone who's going to win is in favor of free trade. So they did move towards laissez-faire, sort of. They could maintain a protected market in India, huge market, but that was protected, no free trade. And they wouldn't let India develop, they wouldn't let other countries move in. And this experiment didn't last very long. The effects of permitting laissez-faire were so harmful to English industrialists and manufacturers and merchants that they pretty soon called off the experiment. And by the 1920s, when Japan was out-competing them, they simply closed off the empire. No more free trade. We'll close off the empire because we can't compete. So free trade is fine if you're going to win, but with restrictions, but not if you're not going to win. Same happens in the United States. The United States was the most probably the most protectionist country in the world from its origins right up to the Second World War, and prospered. By the time you get to the end of the Second World War, the United States was so much in advance of every other country that free trade seemed like a decent idea. The United States literally had half the world's wealth at that time, so fine, let's have free trade with a condition. And the condition was very striking. So, for example, in February 1945, the United States called a hemispheric conference in Mexico, so all the countries came, and the United States essentially dictated an economic charter for the Americas, which was opposed to economic nationalism in all its forms, said everyone has to accept pure market principles, with a single exception, which wasn't mentioned, the United States. Now, the United States instituted massive state intervention in the economy. Now, that's why you have these devices that are here. Through the 1950s in particular, there's huge state expenditures into developing the basis of the modern economy. A lot of it was done right here, in fact, right where we're sitting, down below. Invention of development of computers, the internet, microelectronics, and so on, almost all through the state sector. Now, this went on for decades. But that's kind of an exception. You don't talk about that. So no economic nationalism for anyone else, but a lot of economic nationalism for us. If we make sure that we'll have a powerful interventionist state that ensures profit for the future. And it's still happening. Walk around this neighborhood and take a look at the buildings. You have Novartis, genetic engineering, all the big commercial companies, multinationals. Why are they here? Because they're feeding off of the research that's done through state funding, primarily state funding in the research, in the main research laboratories and university laboratories.